Welcome back to the Everything is a Primary Source podcast, where pop culture is used to learn about history. While secondary sources, which are about a subject, are fine, primary sources, which are from a subject, are even better. And analyzing pop culture as primary sources can reveal just as much about an era in history as the thickest textbook or longest documentary. Chris Van Allsburg's The Polar Express has been a staple of the Christmas season since it was published in 1984, perhaps challenging the night before Christmas as standard bedtime read-alouds on Christmas Eve. Its themes, images, awards, and historical context all signal that this is an exceptional primary source of its time period and place, the early 80s, in the United States. I was beyond elated when an art professor dropped by my setup at Loaded Question Brewery in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, to talk about the Caldecott Award-winning book, The Polar Express.
Andy is joining me for the last podcast of the evening here at Loaded Question in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, and I'm so glad that you selected, without any influence from me, by the way, a Christmas-themed, this is a copy of The Polar Express by Chris Van Allsburg, Caldecott Award-winning book, for obvious reasons. The pictures are amazing.
Which, I had no idea that that was actually a Caldecott Award-winning book. I primarily know it through its more contemporary iterations, specifically, you know, things that are actually out on Amtrak right now.
Yes.
People going out to various locales, whether it's going north from Boston, south from Boston, and experiencing Christmas through the eyes of a very young person, which happens to be our nieces and nephews.
And it is fitting to do that because I feel like train culture is long gone. You know, it's for, I assume we're similar age, you know, we're definitely under the age of 50, you know, and so like trains were never part of our lives, you know, whereas like trains is, I mean, just the cover art alone, it's,
yeah, I mean, especially it's showing a steam engine,
yeah,
so it's definitely not really of this age by any stretch of the
imagination. It's harkening back to an earlier time, potentially a simpler time, and
So I think that you're, like what you're introducing there, the idea that there's this very intentional nostalgia,
right,
to it, and also a nostalgia geared towards a very particular audience, because our nostalgia would not necessarily be that nostalgia. Because my interpretation of a steam engine is Wild West,
right?
Rather than just like, oh, I remember that thing occurring at some point in time in my life.
Because a lot of trains on the East Coast tend to be Amtraks or, you know, the diesel freight trains or subways or T's or something like that. We're not familiar with that image. So the question that we chose is, who is the intended audience or user of the book The Polar Express? Now, the shape of it and the fact that there's an image in every page tells you almost right off the bat who is the intended audience.
So there's the implication that the intended audience is children.
Right.
Because it is a large and engaging image, which is easier to, you know, to capture the imagination, to hold them onto whatever text the parent is giving to them. Because I'm assuming generally bedtime story,
right,
something like that.
I'm curious, considering when it takes place, it takes place on Christmas Eve, if there was an attempt, either consciously or subconsciously, to replace "Twas the Night Before Christmas" as the going to bed on Christmas Eve story. That you know, the idea was to put that idea in your kid's head as they're going off to sleep. That, you know, if you wake up in the middle of the night, and so in front of my house, and I have a young son at home, we actually do have a train track that goes right in front of our house, and so it's perfectly plausible that in the middle of the night he could hear a train go by, it's the Polar Express, you know, and get out and hopefully not run after it. But in this story, this kid doesn't have a train track, yet a train arrives. And so it's very magical. It's almost like instead of in Twas the Night Before Christmas, where Saint Nick is the one who comes to them, and that's like the first real like story of what all other Christmas stories are based on, of Santa Claus being described and coming into your house and delivering presents. I think that was somewhere in the 1820s, 40s or something I was written. This is saying, all right, instead of him coming to you, you're going to go to him, right? And so I got to think that there was a intention, like you just said, parents reading to kids somewhere before Christmas Day in the month of December, and hopefully on Christmas Eve.
Yeah, so this is the pre-Samuel L. Jackson go to F to sleep.
Right.
For the holidays. But yeah, so there's obviously this level of so I guess this is actually where I would say that maybe the foundational question, the premise is slightly off. I think that the design of the text was for children.
Mm-hmm.
I think the text itself was designed for parents.
Right.
And specifically parents of a particular generation, which are going to be closer to probably our parents than parents nowadays. Yeah, because I'm about to turn 40. So
I'm 41, to turn 42. Yeah.
So exactly right there in terms of demographic, you know. So the nostalgia that is sort of baked into this, I think, is for the parents,
right?
And then the visuals are just there as a way for them to feel like, because their children have a rapt attention to this thing, that they're conveying the same feeling to their children that they feel themselves.
Yes.
Based upon this holiday season and everything, regardless of whether or not that's actually what the children feel. So
it's informing them a lot, I think. It's like definitely trying to get them, because like when you finally, I mean, everything about the train ride itself is early 20th century looking. You know, there's nothing about the book that gives it away. Like, even the kid's bedroom at the beginning just has pretty generic toys in the background. There's dartboard.
A hand puppet, a dartboard.
Like
how many kids nowadays, or honestly, even
in the 80s,
when that came out,
so
in the 80s, would have actually had a hand puppet and a dartboard.
Right.
You know, that would have been something that you may have seen in TV, but you wouldn't have seen that in real life necessarily.
So, and then, like, the neighborhood could be any time period. These chefs delivering all the hot chocolate are like out of a hotel kitchen of, you know, the 1910, you know.
And so obviously anyone who has ever been on an Amtrak knows that is not the way that the world works, at least in America.
Yeah, nowadays, like you said, the Polar Express now is kind of like, here's your hot chocolate, you know. It's like, it's not this magical event. And then when they get to the North Pole, so I haven't forced myself, and I don't think I ever will, to watch the movie with Tom Hanks that they made. And I remember when I saw the previews for it years ago when it was coming out, I'm like, oh, they ruined the Polar Express. Because with CGI and like a roller coaster scene and the train going across the ice, I'm like, there's nothing like that in the book. You get the idea of like a steady, you know, just chugging along through the dark of night. He poetically says it so well, and then they made this movie. It's like off the wall wackiness, you know.
So I mean, with that, I think that's also sort of talking about intended audience of book versus intended audience of movie.
Yeah.
Because between those two things, where you'd pointed out this was published in the, you said 80s,
85, 80s?
So mid 80s. Yeah. All right. Since then, you know, the internet has absolutely exploded.
Yeah.
Right now, you look at the random content that is added at any given point, there is an 80 to an 85% likelihood that whatever is added on the internet is video-based.
Right.
So everything has gone towards the moving image. It's gone away from this idea of the static image, because in the mid-80s, the static image was the primary image that there was. You think about what's happening in the art world? You think about what is happening in the vast majority of consumed culture outside of television. Mm-hmm. It's all static. So now, all of a sudden, the vast majority of culture is consumed outside of television. It has to mirror television.
Right.
It goes back to that whole Marshall McLuhan, the medium's the message thing. It's reflexive. The internet was just the television put on access all the time, as opposed to it was delivered to you.
Right.
It's you making the decision what you're seeing. And so I think there was a logical shift there in the way that they moved it. Because they know that they need to have this engagement, they purposely made it more fantastical to develop that.
And it's funny how that's almost embedded in the story, because the little boy, his, you know, the narrator, has a choice to get on the train or not. Mm. And it's almost like, are you getting on this new era or not? Are you gonna? Because this book, you know, we know it's made in 1985. It could have been from 1955. You know, you could see it back then. Aesthetically, it looks very similar to, well, you know, the higher end books of that era.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like it's been a long day. The
Norman Rockwell almost.
Yeah. The illustrations are very Rockwellian, and he was also very adamant about the fact that he was not trying to portray like normal American life. He was trying to portray an idealized version of American life in the vast majority of his work. He was trying to say, you know, if we all better ourselves and elite, you know, get up to these higher ideals of what humanity could be, this is what life could be. Everybody could be on a slightly higher plane than they're at now. And this is definitely hearkening back to that imagery without necessarily following along the social arc that Rockwell was suggesting that we needed to attain in order for that to happen.
It's almost like, and I've understood that Chris Van Allsburg, and when I met him and he signed this copy for me, he was just kind of like, oh, another copy of the Polar Express. You know, I've written Jumanji and Zathura. You know, like, I have other books, you know. He seems kind of like, again, with the same, you know, like, that's, I like that I've been to the book, but it's not my favorite. It's not his big, you know, it's not his magnum opus that, you know, I think people assume that it is. And I wonder if he almost regrets making it because people hold it on that pedestal of being Rockwellian or...
Yeah, I would actually wonder, I would go back to him and just ask very specifically, you know, why is that not your favorite? Because it seems like with the structure of those stories, especially like you bring up Jumanji, you know, that's about this idea of nature having this magical quality that is inherently non-Western.
Mm.
This story, The Polar Express, is overwhelmingly Western.
Right.
And so it makes me wonder if that was part of his thought process in describing that way, is just saying, I wish that I had allowed people to have a broader perspective of what this magical situation could be. Because that is very much what Jumanji was just like, oh.
Right.
It's a board game. It's whatever you build up in your mind. It's not this narrative that has been said for so many times. It's been repeated. That has been sold to us.
Right.
You know.
And Zathura is out of this world. I mean, it's actually off Earth, and so it can't be east, west, north. You know, it's all. And you're absolutely with a locomotive, a train, and there are trains all over the world, but there's just one train that pulls into the North Pole, and it's full of kids from North America, and that's it. Like, it's not, that's an excellent point, and one that I think fit in pretty well in 1985. You know, it was the return of America as the great shining, you know,
the city
on the hill. That it was that bold, and it's not just in books that you see it, it's in all sorts of media that is represented. And maybe that's why he thinks, not my best, maybe too narrow of a view.
So it definitely could be that, but I do wonder if it's just the fact that there aren't really, you know, in the last few years, there have been given sort of like dark alternatives to the Christmas fable.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, there's, there's this great Finnish film called Rare Exports that's about like Santa Claus was actually this dark being that's much more like
they have also the Krampus movies.
So it's more like Krampus and this sort of thing. But it makes me wonder if he just like realized that he went into a trope. But then with these other things, he had the opportunity to just say, these are possibilities. These are ways for you to imagine the way that the universe worked rather than the way that we know that the world right now works.
That's an excellent deduction. That's a good dissection. I mean, it's like one of those things that I'm so glad you came up here, because with your background as an art instructor and studying and everything like that, this is perfect selection, to be combing over and saying about the time period, because one thought that also entered my head is, think about some of the other Christmas stories that are being invented or reinvented in the same era. A Christmas Story came out in 1983, didn't do extremely well in the theater, but it got a cult following almost immediately on tape. That movie, the entire thing looks like a moving Norman Rockwell painting.
Yeah, absolutely.
It doesn't really specify the exact year.
And that's by design.
By design, right? There's kind of like the old days, nostalgia.
Yeah, because he wants every single person to be able to say, I understand that.
Exactly. And the new one, by the way, is fantastic. I don't know if you've seen it yet. A Christmas Story. Blew me away. It was just a perfectly good movie. The last 2 minutes was just like amazing, because they tap into that raw human emotion that we were missing in movies for a long time. But so that's a nostalgia movie. It's a Wonderful Life came out in 1946 for the 40th anniversary. They colorized it and put it on VHS. So 1986, the following year, all three of those stories, including the Polar Express, have a very similar age that they're pulling from visually, and the simplicity factor of those before times, before things got complicated,
because we didn't talk about them,
right?
It's not that we didn't put it on the open, it was just that they were unspoken. So it paints
and A Christmas Story is pretty honest. You see the parents squabble, you see kind of they're not wealthy people, they working class household in the Midwest, and they're kind of eating boiled food for dinner every night, and it's not like they're living the high life kind of thing, but it's about you go through your struggles, but you're gonna be okay because you're safe at home, and you got like to bring it back to this story. One of my favorite parts in A Christmas Story, it's just an establishing shot scene where you see the steel mills in the background and you hear the lonely whistle of a train, and it just like, it sets me, like I lived in Dover for a time, and I lived fairly close to the Amtrak station, and sometimes in the middle of the night I would hear the whistle blowing, and it just was that such a comforting sound,
No, it's very interesting that you say that. So I grew up in the Midwest. I'm from Kansas City originally.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, where they have one of the largest switching.
I was gonna say they have a couple trains there. Yeah.
And that's a thing where, as my wife and I move around from place to place, I'm constantly like, how far are the trains away? Because I want to hear it in the summertime,
Right.
Every time I have the windows open, I want to hear that soft little thing, because it's nostalgic. And that was, I think, also sort of baked into the mix, is that there was always this nostalgia built into work and industry in the American fable. And this is really just an iteration of that that just happens to be sort of like truncated at the time that, oh, Christmas falls here.
Right.
So we're gonna throw this in there too. So there's levels upon levels in lots of ways.
I mentioned at the beginning, I don't travel on train very often, but I did for a time travel on train pretty frequently when I would go across New York State to see family. And some of those towns, a lot of Rust Belt, towns, they still have the old advertisements painted onto the brick walls. I felt like I was driving through a train set. And at Christmas time, especially, that's when I'd oftentimes go travel on the train. with the light dusting of snow on it. It was beautiful. It was like that relationship you're talking about of industry, commercialism, and but in a nice way, not in a intrusive, you know, it's like that 1930s, 40s vibe that you get, like pre-war, you know, just everything's kind of working, not great, but we're gonna get it working, you know, and it's nice. And that actually brings me up to another, are you familiar with the artist Bill Peet?
No.
He worked for Disney for a long time. He was the chief illustrator on, I think, the Jungle Book and a few others in that same time period, okay. You know, 50s, 60s. And then he went off and started writing his own children's books. But he was also a graphic designer and an artist. And he did portraits and stuff and paintings, landscapes. And he was from the Midwest and Indiana, I think, outside Indianapolis. And his favorite subjects to paint from a young age were trains.
Okay.
You know, his earliest memories include, you know, seeing the trains go by with all the tanks and the cars for World War One, heading from the factory to the, you know, the seaports to be shipped off, and like taking that in. And if you ever get the chance to read his autobiography, it's an illustrated autobiography, so kind of like this. Look how we bring it all home. It's a super thick book, but it's every page is illustrated.
Yeah.
The text is not for kids. It's, you know, it's not like swear words and stuff, but it's just like,
yeah, but it's
for an older audience, and he's telling his life story, but he illustrates it all the way through. It's one of my favorite biographies. And it's I would say for the same purposes and same kind of themes of that industrial train built America. And this is what it produced. You know, like, if you like that Disney movie, well, this guy that fell in love with trains and, you know, it's like that decision of, like, when does technology enter art? You know,
yeah.
Like...
Yeah, I feel like... So this is going to be, like, a slight tangent off of that, but it's... Yeah, I find it really interesting that it's showing a steam engine as opposed to a diesel engine.
Right.
Yeah, because the steam engine was just there because it was the mechanism of the time, and they actively, you know, the engineers that were designing trains were moving away from that specifically because trains weren't designed to move people anymore. You know, we already had cars and airplanes and all that sort of stuff. And so this is hearkening back to a time before we thought about the sheer movement of our bodies through space,
right?
At certain intervals, like you know, you Amtrak trains nowadays, they're all diesel engines because that's the only kind of engine that you can get aside from the cog railway, or
right?
Something like that. The Amtrak trains are actually the least efficient trains running in the entire U.S., even though it's the exact same motors, because they're just not moving as much cargo.
Right.
You know? And so, yeah, I think there's this really interesting thing about how the technology ends up being sort of like this almost... The display of the technology becomes a pastiche in many ways for that nostalgic aspect built into it.
So an actual engineer, both a train engineer and a, you know, builder engineer would look at the Polar Express and be like, totally inefficient. I could get you to the North Pole in a much better way.
Especially 1985.
Right.
Especially
they're going to be like, this is totally foolish. But thank you so much for ending the night on such a great, great way. I can't thank you enough for coming by. Actually, I can thank you by buying you a beer.
Well,
but
don't worry about that. But I'll go read this book now.
Excellent.
This is the EPS Podcast. I hope you've enjoyed listening to what you've heard so far. Short episodes like this one, which are products of my EPS Podcast Live exhibits, will be coming out on Tuesdays this season, while longer episodes, deeper dives into subjects, are posted on Thursdays. Follow the show on social media, including YouTube, and especially on Instagram. I look forward to you tuning in again to the EPS Podcast, where everything is a primary source.